We are doing pheromones today. Is Juliet out there someplace? There she is. I didn't see you. Juliet, we'll pass this back to you. This, give this to Sam. But if you want to see what's in there, I just have a piece of tape on there because it tells you what they do and stuff, kind of. If you want to do that. Okay, so we're ready to do focus. Got to focus now. Okay. Before I do the pheromones, I do want to step back one step and talk just a little bit more about the PAP testing they do for brisket disease, high mountain disease, high altitude disease. What part of the heart was going to get screwed up? The right side. And you got to remember, the heart is like really two pumps side by side, and so it's going to be right heart failure. Maybe the left side is going to be normal. It can happen like that. And I think in your reading, and I can't remember because I've looked at so many pictures now, but anyway, they put these cattle in a chute and then they use some kind of pressure probe. How would you get a probe into the right side of the heart? And you have like this little tube. Anybody know? Your anatomy, what vessel would you put a tube in? And if you, I've done this with animals, and you, this tube, you just keep feeding it into this vessel, and you can guesstimate about where you'll be into the heart. What vessel? The jugular vein. Where does the jugular vein lead to? The right atrium. And then the right ventricle. So it's not too complicated, because I put a lot of cannulas down the jugular vein, and for pigs, we always figured it was in the right atrium by the time we put it down there. And that's how they do that. So you can do it, there's really no surgery at all. You just, the jugular, if you've ever taken blood samples from cattle, that jugular is sitting there, you can pop that thing out easy to puncture. Anyway, I just want to make sure you guys knew it was right heart. You can slide a pressure sensor down into the, I'm not sure if they go to the right atrium or all the way down to the right ventricle. I have a feeling they probably put this little probe in the right ventricle. Remember, after a couple, 3 weeks at altitude, high altitude, and then measure the pressure. Okay, so now we're on to pheromones. So in the reading, we have, you know, we started with organophosphates for, you know, exam two material. Now we're down into, I can't remember what it's called. If it's called pheromones, it might be something like that, whatever. Anyway, we're doing pheromones, and this is a picture of a book, I guess, and it's maybe on clear here, but that's an insect. And insects are famous for giving off pheromones and affecting other insects. It's such a state of art that you can order pheromones for insects out of a catalog. Okay? Can't really do that with livestock except for boars, which I'll talk about a little bit later. Okay, so pheromones is the topic today. And I've seen this picture many times and I just thought it's kind of comical. I cannot remember what this company was investigating. It might have been they had to eat something or it was a deodorant. I cannot remember. But can you imagine going to work every day and doing that? That would be not good, I don't think. Okay, here we go. Okay, so pheromones. And some of these slides, you know, I don't make these, but it's really kind of fun to look at them. And I will say things that you should know for the test. Okay. Pheromones are chemicals that animals use to communicate. And then a little sidebar is you should write down three ways animals communicate with each other. One would be pheromones. What's two other ways animals, like, you know, if we had two dogs here Monday, we didn't, we had Harlan, but how do they communicate with each other? Like, think of cattle in a pasture. We'll talk about cattle pheromones in a little bit. How else do animals communicate with each other? body language slash sight slash visual cues, okay? Because, you know, like dogs, you have two male dogs coming up, the body language definitely starts out. What's another way? The third way, little side margin here.
Verbally?
What's that?
Verbally.
Yeah, verbally. Vocalizations. Thank you. Yeah. So now we're talking about pheromones, which are a very subtle way of communication, right? And it's well known in the insect world. There's all kinds of pheromones. We're not going to really talk about that much. We're going to talk about these animals here, where the key is pheromones communicate across the same species, from one member of the species to the other. Okay, so then, what I wanted to get out of here is, I've never seen this much, but pheromones are ectohormones. You know, ecto is an interesting prefix, because you can have ectoparasites. You can have endoparasites. Here they're talking about pheromones are ectohormones, meaning they act outside of the body that's making them. That's not a term you'll often see, because then if you have ectohormones, then maybe there's a term called endohormones, and that's not really a good term. We all say hormones. So I don't like that, but I thought I'm going to bring it up because maybe you'll see it someplace and then you'll know it's really pheromones are the better. They're usually produced by glands, sometimes in the skin. Now, and then I have a correction here too. That's the beautiful thing about seeing other people's work. It's like, oh, you know, I'm not sure if that's right. Okay, by some glands located in the skin, could be sweat glands, or there's all kinds of glands, or by ducts within the body that have ducts leading to the body's exterior. The second variety of glands are known as exocrine glands. Do you know what? All that's exocrine glands. So they're trying to say, just because you have something inside the body, within the body, they're saying that's exocrine. Sweat glands are exocrine glands. Anal glands in the dog are exocrine. But the thing is, the pancreas is an exocrine gland. It doesn't have to be on the surface of the skin. Because, you know, you could have a book called the exocrine pancreas, and you can have another book called the endocrine pancreas, because it's a mixed gland. It makes things in the duct, pancreatic juice. So anyway, that's kind of wrong. They're made by exocrine glands, usually. Or they're in also other body solutions, but I guess saliva is an exocrine product, right? So exocrine glands is a very common way for these materials to get to the exterior. Okay, so pheromones. We just said this, right? You can communicate by pheromones or light, that's really visual, and then the auditory. Chemical released by an animal that affects behavior or development of the same species. Through, here's the new one, taste. Maybe some of those pheromones can get on the tongue, because there's not much difference between your tongue and the sense of smell, because it all relies on what's called chemoreceptors. That's all one word. And a chemoreceptor is some organ that takes in chemicals and then sends messages to the brain. But all the messages to the brain are all action potentials. So I could see where some pheromones can land on the tongue and give a message to the animal. Okay, and then they're always, insects are always a great example, but anyway, could be taste. Now what's the sense of taste? What's technically that called? What's that called? What's that?
Gustatory.
Yeah, gustation. G-U-S-T-A-T-I-O-N. And the sense of smelling is olfaction, O-L-F-A-C-T-I-O-N, okay? So you have olfaction and gustation, okay? Next thing, okay, pheromones. Animals communicate by spreading gnats, pheromones, specific, okay. I guess this one I was trying to say, some of the, and we'll be talking about this for boars and cattle either late today or Monday. is pheromones are relying, talking about messages about reproduction, okay? Here's the other thing. Usually, the reproductive pheromones are not produced until after puberty. Why is that? Now, I'm talking about domestic animals. I'm not talking about insects. I don't know much about insects. Why is it that most of the reproductive pheromones wouldn't be found before puberty? They wouldn't have any use, okay, right, Chris? Well, I guess, yeah, you're looking at the big picture. You would, why make pheromones when you're not ready to produce? And so there's like this key event that happens at puberty. What's the internal event that happens at puberty? Or, you know, there's a little range. What is it? Something starts working. It's a G word. Or it's a T word in males, and it's an O word. The gonads. The gonads don't start working until puberty, right? They're not doing anything. They're growing with the rest of the body, but the gonads are not working until puberty. That's the idea. The definition of puberty is when the gonad first releases a gamete into the duct system. Make sure you understand that definition of puberty. It's the first time the gonad releases a gamete into a duct system. So then let's take that. What does that mean in the female? The first time a... What's that? Well, heat, but okay, you know what? That brings up a good point. I'm going to talk about cattle, how cattle can be in heat but not be in puberty yet. It's interesting. So in females, it's when the ovum first gets into the oviduct. Doesn't that match gonad releasing a gamete into the duct system? So in the female, it's the ovary releasing an ovum, and it goes into the oviduct. That's puberty, the first time that happens. In the male, it's a little more complicated, but what could you say? In the male, it's when a sperm cell first is released into the seminiferous tubule, or you could say vas deferens. Probably the most proper is when a sperm cell is released into a seminiferous tubule. They're made in the seminiferous tubules, but they don't go into a lumen of the seminiferous tubule till puberty. Do you know you can take any gonad from any domestic animal and give it to me, and I can tell you if the animal's reached puberty or not? Okay. Anyway, let's go on. I lost my pointer. Okay, here we go. I did not draw this, but it's pretty good. There's two olfactory systems, mane and accessory. The mane is when you cook bacon this morning. Anybody have bacon this morning? Okay, there we go up here. I'm jealous. Anyway, when you smell bacon, that's the mane olfactory system. And that's outlined here in this label, olfactory epithelium. It's a, is that blue or turquoise or whatever? And here it is. The mane olfactory system tends to be dorsal and caudal in the nasal cavity. Dorsal, caudal. Up here. This isn't good for showing you the nasal cavity, but anyway. And it's a bunch of cells that have nerves going to the brain. The accessory olfactory system tends to be ventral and rostral. When you're in the head, you can't say cranial. So the accessory olfactory system tends to be ventral and rostral. And that's here. And here's a name for it, the vomeral nasal organ. That's the accessory olfactory system, vomeral nasal organ. Okay, and it's still, look at the dotting, the dot line. That's still sending neurons or action potentials to some site. Okay, we'll give you another name for the vomeral nasal organ. Anybody know it? Another name for the vomeral nasal organ. You got nobody in the room knows that from any biology past anything? Okay, Jacobson's organ. Jacobson's organ is also this vomeral nasal organ. And then I guess along we're talking about anatomy, I got some other anatomy things, but I'll talk about it now. Maybe the other pictures will show this. The main olfactory system is kind of exposed on the surface and air flows by it during inspirations. So it's kind of like exposed on this wall. Like if this was olfactory epithelium, the air would flow here and then during exhalation come back. It doesn't work that way down here. The accessory olfactory system, or the vomeronasal organ, or the Jacobson organ, think of it as a cigar that's hollowed out. And it's blind-ended. One of the ends of the cigar is open, and the cavity is there, but air doesn't flow through the vomeronasal organ. It comes in, and then it goes out. Okay? That's different than flowing by the epithelium. Okay, so to refresh everybody's memory, and I know some of these when they get blown up they're a little fuzzy, but this is the main olfactory system. Remember, it's dorsal and then caudal. So the nares, N-A-R-E-S would be up here, right? Nares are the opening of the nose cavity. So look at, you can even see this. Airborne molecules are going to interact with this, these receptor cells flowing back this way, okay? And so that's a chemoreceptor right there. There's so many, they're going to be sensitive to certain things, and then once they reach threshold, they're going to send a message to the brain, right? So you can smell bacon, or you can smell a rotting apple, or you can smell, what's another good thing? A rose. Who got roses yesterday? Okay, good. Good for you. Okay, here we go. Now, this isn't orientated the same way. There's the nares, air coming by, and notice dorsal caudal is the main olfactory system. It's always got moisture on it. And then this is showing us that the olfactory nerve takes messages to the brain, okay? It doesn't show the vomeral nasal organ, but that would be ventral and rostral right in here. Okay, another depiction, because sometimes when you're reading books, you might say, oh, I don't know what that means. MOE, main olfactory epithelium, because this is all epithelium. So if you ever see that, and notice how it's following my rule, dorsal and caudal, and the vomeral nasal organ is ventral and more rostral, okay? And they're just showing the connections. All this stuff, it has to interact. Okay, there's another depiction. This one I picked because see how it looks like it's a dead end system, and then you have to flow back out that way, versus this, it's flowing by. That's kind of important because then maybe an animal has to do something special to draw in air here. Anybody know what I'm alluding to? What does an animal have to do maybe sometimes to really draw air in there because it's not flowing by? The Flamin response. And we'll get spelling that. Very good. Okay. Let's just look at this. Jacobson organ. Oh yeah, anatomy. Oh yeah, there's another new message here. Okay. The sense, okay, detects pheromones. Yes, 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 yes. Some K track. Here it is. Here's what I wanted to point out. Humans are born with a Jacobson's organ. but early on it dwindles to the point of uselessness. So I have a feeling that's not an absolute statement. I bet you there are some people that are born with Jacobson's organ and it might be functional, right? You can see how biology is variable. I bet you, and you know, a lot of cases they doubt if pheromones have any effect on people, but I have a feeling there'll be some people. Oh, in fact, yeah. I'll have to tell you about a little thing we did in Nebraska one time. I'm not sure if it helps or supports that or not. Okay, supposedly, way back in history, maybe humans did use this organ to locate mates. And then somebody's trying to be funny. Now, singles evenings, chat rooms, and bars have taken the place of that. Okay, somebody's trying to be funny. Then they could also add farmers.com, right? Okay, the number of scent receptors. I thought this was funny. I mean, not funny, but good. You might want to write these numbers down. The human supposedly has about 5 million receptor cells. Think of it that way. And this is in the main olfactory system. And then look at these breeds of dogs, and it varies. I guess that's not really surprising. Bloodhounds are famous, so maybe it makes sense that they have 300 million. And those are really not estimates. Do you know you could section olfactory epithelium histologically, and there's a way, it's called morphometric techniques. I've done this in like testes. You do a let's put that down, morphometric techniques. Maybe sometime I should talk about that. Morpho, M-O-R-P-H-O, morphometric, that's all one word. Morphometric techniques, where you can take tissue, put it under the microscope, and do certain things over a number of tissue slides, and you can estimate numbers. And that's how they did this. They would take these dogs, obviously, if you're gonna do that with the olfactory epithelium, you're gonna do that after death for those guys. And section it, and yeah, so that gives me an idea. Sometime I'm going to give you a little sidebar about morphometric techniques. You can quantify the number of items, whatever you want to talk about, in a tissue. Okay, anyway, that's pretty interesting. Bloodhounds, people that have bloodhounds say that they're so keened into smelling, and those big ears come down, they'll follow a scent and ride out to the highway and get run over because they just are so focused on the scent. They're not even looking where they're going. Okay, cats also have olfactory epithelium, and I thought this was interesting. Humans have 2 to 4 square centimeters. That's what that's supposed to say there. Cats have 20 square centimeters, so almost 10 times what a person has. And then here's the number of scent receptors. You could say receptors, you can say cells, because one cell is a receptor. Humans, 5 million. That agrees with the last one, right? But it didn't have cats. Cats have 200 million. Okay. There's the spelling again, vomal nasal organs. Okay, what do we take home from here? Now, in insects, there's all kinds of categories of pheromones, but for the domestic animals, there's 2 main ones we want to talk about. Signaling pheromones, and the other one is priming pheromones. And so let me tell you about both of those. Signaling pheromone, and there's like a little mnemonic device to remember which pheromone does what. So the signaling is something like you're marking your territory, or a family member smells, like a dog smells a family member, and it's immediate. It's like, oh, I recognize you. Oh, this is not my territory. There's no thinking that involves. It's a message that's right away. So it's kind of like a traffic signal. It's right away, right? It's like stop, go. There's nothing that's going to go on beyond that. In the priming, the P to me says it does something physiological inside, and that means it takes a while. So signaling is immediate, like, oh yeah, you're my family member, or yes, this is not my territory. Priming does something internally, oftentimes involving other parts of the brain, like the hypothalamus and pituitary, especially the reproductive hormone. Okay? So that's two types, priming and signaling. And signaling, if you remember, like a signal, a red light, it tells you something immediate. And we're going to be talking about the priming effects in cattle and pigs. Okay.
I remember. See, all these slides are not my own, but they always remind me of something.
So obviously, that's not how we spell odor, but right, this is like the British English. Often present in urine, anal glands, you name it, in any secretion that can come out of the animal, there's going to be probably pheromones in it. And look at, they have priming, which I don't like their definition here, generalized response, that doesn't make sense. Signaling kind of makes sense, immediate something, okay? Flamen, there's our spelling for Alicia that said flamen. It's called the flamen response. Sometimes it's called the flamen posture, or just flamen. Now, in some animals, especially in males, there's a very, okay, let's do it this way. In boars, big boars. How many have ever worked with big boars that are chomping and, you know, saliva? You know what I'm talking about. Smelly. Where the urine in the sheath where the penis is, oftentimes there's a whole bunch of junk in there. And it's bacteria, it's dead cells, and it collects at the end of the penis in this pouch. What's that called? What's that? Smegma. S-M-E-G-M-A. Smegma. Is that what you said?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, where did you learn that?
I have a horse. I'm gelding.
Oh, that's right. Could you bring...
Can you bring some in?
A bean.
He probably has to be clean, so I probably could enter spring break.
Okay. Really, sometime try to bring in a bean. That brings up a good point. Okay, smegma. S-M-E-G-M-A. Smegma is a collection of urine, dead cells, bacteria that tends to collect in the end of the sheath of animals. Horse, for some reason, they call them beans because they are kind of bean-shaped.
They can be.
Yeah. They can be. In the big boar, they're never going to be bean-shaped at all. They're going to be just...
Because they can completely block their urethra.
Oh, yeah.
Stop being able to urinate.
Yeah.
Which is why you have to...
For the horse you're talking about. Yeah. It's a physical kind of plug almost. Yeah. In boars, it doesn't get that way. But dogs can have smegma. There's always a normal amount, but you can have abnormal amounts of smegma. And like the horse is a good example. So if you want to bring one in a zip bag, it'd be kind of neat. Smegma, show and tell. Okay, so the flamen response. Let's look at this. I thought this was neat. What the flamen? Okay, so here's a tiger. Thank you. and it's making this flamen response. And here's the kicker. Supposedly, that draws air into the vulvo-nasal organ. That's the theory. When an animal does that, it draws air into that cigar-shaped structure, right? So there's a line. There's a cat. We've had enough anatomy. Anyway, that's the flamen. There's a good example. Flamen. Another example. There's one. Now, what's kind of interesting, did you notice that the horse has upper incisors? The sheep don't. Sheep, and if you don't realize this, see that? What's that called? There's no incisors, but this structure, you can say, is the dental pad, it's called. So for sheep and cattle, no upper incisors. Just a little sidebar on anatomy here. Okay, and there's the bull with a flamen. The rings in the nose sometimes work, sometimes they'll pull them right out there if they're mad enough. Okay, so then, this is obviously a boar, probably Duroc. Never ask you that. And boars have this incredible large pair of testicles compared to most animals. Like most animals that size would not have those testicles. And what's interesting is it's kind of related to the sow. And too bad we don't have a sow track, but you know a big sow track? If I had Alyssa hold your hand up. If I had her hold one end, like the ovary end, and I cut all the ligaments that were keeping it crooked, the other end would be over here in the sow.
We could probably borrow one from Dr. Stewart.
Yeah.
She gets them
all the time, yeah. And a big sow has a long reproductive tract. And so you need a lot of sperm, but you also need a lot of seminal plasma, right? And if you're not familiar with boars, and I've collected, how many have collected semen from boars here in this room? Okay, good, about 3-4. Would you agree that it could probably overfill this cup? You could overfill this cup with semen from one boar at one time. Okay, so then we want to talk about pheromones in the boar. And what is it about boars? What's it called when you cook boar meat and boar taint? Thank you. Boar taint is caused by these two chemicals, androstenone and skatol. So boars, when they're sold, do not go into pork chops.
Sometimes
they do, yeah.
My dad still won't eat pork chops because he had that one time like 30 years ago and he still won't. He said it tasted like a pig smells.
Yeah.
And he still can't eat pork.
Now here's the kicker. Not 100% of the human population can smell that stuff. There are some people that would say, I don't smell anything, where a lot of people would say, this stinks. So you have this meat that's got these chemicals in it, but you're going to sell it. You've got to sell the boar. You're not going to like just put them to the rendering plant. And I can tell you they go into some meat products. Where does boar meat go to?
Pepperoni.
Yes. Sausage. Cover up everything with spices and other smells. So here it is. Androstenone is made in the testes. Skatol is made in the intestines by bacteria. But they both contribute to boar taint. And I wanted to concentrate maybe more on this left panel. So I'll get over here so I'm not in people's ways. But you're going to find it in the plasma, right? You can take a blood sample and find this in plasma. It's also kind of stored in fat. It's called boar taint. It's also found in saliva. And that's what they figure, you know, we could call this a sex pheromone in the boar. You could also say smegma. It's going to be found in smegma as well, the androstenone. The skatol is a little different. It contributes to boar taint. It's probably not a pheromone, but I just thought it'd be interesting to tell you about the boar taint problem. Okay, so then how do we use boar pheromones? Here's how you do it. There's the boar in the background. Obviously, there's the testes. And he's being bombarded by these young gilts. And this is how you expose young gilts to the boar, because he's got pheromones all over, in the urine, in the saliva, probably his sweat. And it stimulates the young gilts to come into puberty. Okay? So what we're talking about here is prepubertal gilts being stimulated to come into puberty earlier than if they weren't exposed to the boar. And look at how much interest he's got, right? And the thing is, this boar, the older, the smellier, the better. Okay? Because sometimes if you use a young boar and you bring him into a pen, he's intimidated by all the guilts that are coming up to him, right? If you have an old boar, there's nothing that's really going to stop him. He's, you know, smelly. He goes, I've been around the block here. This is easy. Tell me something about the vulva of guilts. Anybody know?
It gets red and swollen, and there's like, it's like you can see, kind of, you have to touch it to see if you can feel it, and then they'll start to lock up if they're interested in him.
Yes, and lock up is a great term. Lock up means if a boar, if they're in heat now,
they're standing.
It's called standing heat. Lockup is not a bad term because they tend to lock all four legs, arch their back, and if they're truly in heat, you could come up behind them and try to move them, and you can't move them. So lockup is a good term. Now, what about something else about the vulva and gilts? Let's say you have 100 gilts, and you're wondering if they all reach puberty. Anybody know how you could look at all the vulvas and you could tell the ones that didn't reach puberty? Because at puberty, the reproductive tract gets bigger and the vulva gets bigger. And sometimes in swine, what's it called when even they're old enough to be way past puberty, but they're not? What's that called? What kind of reproductive tract do they have? Because this will happen in a few gills. They'll have what's called an infantile reproductive tract. And you can tell that from the outside. If you have 100 gills, notice how I said 100, and you can do this relatively speaking, you can see all the ones that have reached puberty. All those vulvas are about the same size, but if there's one with a true infantile reproductive tract, the vulva will be markedly smaller versus her herd mates. Anyway, you do this and you get a response. So let's look at this. Critical, must be done well, whatever. Okay, so here it is. Gilts exposed to boars at 140 to 170 days show puberty at 180 to 200. So this is, they're inducing puberty, and I guess I'm going to say their control is this. Let's say their control is, if you average that, what it would be, 220 days. So let's say there's a 20-day hastening of puberty. Does that mean you can breed them 20 days earlier? The answer is no. You don't breed them earlier than you normally would. So you might say, what's the advantage of inducing earlier puberty when you're not going to breed them any younger than the other ones that, let's say, don't get the boar exposure? What's the key? Why do you induce earlier puberty? You get an extra estrous cycle. And what does that do?
Because in the first estrous cycle, their litter size is going to be way smaller.
Their ovulation rate is always low. Quote, unquote, low, whatever that means. Yeah. So what happens is, if you induce puberty earlier, and then you have a standard time to breed them, you're going to get one or two piglets more. And if you look at how many gilts you could have, that would be an incredible number of pigs more, right? So you want them to have more estrous cycles before you breed them. It's not like you're going to breed them any younger. So quite a deal there. Okay, let's see. I think I've got data for one. Yeah, here it is, the data, and then on. Okay, so you know how I always have stories about these people? Remember I.A. Shipper and his little quizzy? Do you guys remember that story? Okay, good. This Zimmerman was my advisor for my PhD program. He was actually co-advisor, him and Ron Christensen. So look at this. He checked with a boar, yes or no. In the winter, if you do it, percent puberty by 225 days, 89%. But if you didn't use a boar, 50%. In summer, You had 74% puberty by 225 days, but only 14. Look at that. That's dramatic there. And so that's kind of like proof positive that the boar exposure will induce earlier puberty. Let me see if I got one more. Do I go?
What's the difference between, like, how come in the winter they're more likely to do it?
Yeah, the good question is why the season different. I don't know, because they might have been maybe more outside versus inside. I don't know. Because this was like, I ran across this. I don't remember this experiment. They probably did that before I got there. But yeah. So the true thing is, look at winter, look at that difference, and then that difference. And somehow summer, you get less coming into puberty. And I'm not sure if it's heat related, because that's the other thing that will make you not detect estrus as well, if it's really hot. So I don't know if that's the case or not. Okay, I'm going to end there because I got beef, but I don't have enough time to do beef. But when we come back Monday, we will be doing bull stuff.